This is a journey into sound. A journey which along the way will bring to you new color, new dimension, new value, and a new experience.
Welcome to the Ghee Spot podcast. I'm your guide, Katie Silcox, bringing you your weekly self-love soundbite. Join us for conversations around sex, spirit, and all things self-care. All things self-care.
This is a journey into sound.
Hi everybody, Katie Silcox here with the Ghee Spot. We're so happy to have you back this week on the podcast. And I am feeling happy and excited to talk about Tantra again as a part of our ongoing series, the Tantra Talks, kind of debunking some of the myths around Tantra and also encouraging Tantra to evolve, to be more available to everyone and to evolve itself into the reality of a modern world in which we all find ourselves. The ancient teachings mean nothing if they can't meet the people and the place and the time in which they are being presented. And so I'm just one of many translators and little worker bees attempting to continue to evolve these beautiful love and power practices. And so if you are new to the podcast and new to the ideas and philosophies of Tantra as a concept, go back and listen to our first two Tantra talks. So you'll be a little caught up, but you don't have to do that. We're going to dive right in. Today, I want to talk about an interesting topic around walking into, you know, one of my favorite definitions of yoga is the practice and act of making that which I'm unaware of, something that I am now aware of, turning darkness into light, unconsciousness into consciousness. And the Bible says it beautifully, if you bring forth that which is in you, then it will help make you whole. If you do not bring forth that which is in you, it will annihilate you. And I'm not quoting the Bible perfectly, but that's in there. I'm sure some of you Bible experts out there can write us and tell us the exact verse. But the point of it is what matters. And the point is that all of us are walking around with aspects of ourselves and that are actually guiding a lot of our feelings and our behaviors that we may not be aware of. And we can think about this in terms of the current paradigm that we find ourselves in, which is a very patriarchal and masculine paradigm, which, as many of you listeners know, it's being blasted apart, right? And so movements like Me Too and Black Lives Matter and the entire political spectrum right now are simply a symptom of the demise and the fallibility of the past system. And this is a good thing. Like it doesn't feel good by any stretch of the imagination, but in order for things to evolve, they need to oftentimes be destroyed. The old has to be destroyed to build the new temple. And so this old paradigm that has pretty much nothing to do with men today, meaning it's no man's fault. When we say the masculine, we mean all of us, right? What we've inherited. And yet, men, if we look at our current power structures and economic structures, are the ones who are most passionately clinging to the old way. And so what we have in a very general way of speaking is this wave of the feminine in women, right, and men, but largely in women, that is saying there's a part of me and there's a part of us that has been buried and lost. And it's now becoming unbearable for me to keep it buried inside of my own mind, body, psyche, soul, right? That's happening. And it's happening in women. And you see these great movements of women, but it's happening in everybody. And what am I speaking about? What I'm speaking about is this lost feminine, this lost goddess. We can think about it from an anthropological perspective. Back in the day when there was still this connection to the goddess, when the patriarchal cultures took over in almost everywhere in the world, with the exception of a few places, all of the goddess iconography, sculpture, symbols, were actually buried in the ground. That's amazing, right? Many of them were destroyed. Most were destroyed, but many were buried in the ground. It was illegal, right? You could be killed for pagan worship of the goddess. And so all of these iconography symbols were burned off, right? Destroyed or buried. And so you can think about that, and it's an interesting thing to do. From a historical perspective, we could become very scholarly and academic about it, but the goddess does not like to be academic and scholarly. She can use it for her good, but I want us to try to stay in the realm of the body right now, and the intuition and the imagination and the creativity. She loves to live there. And so I'm just going to give you guys a little bit of the logical structure and the history, only in as much as it can kind of give the part of your brain a context for something that's way bigger and way more important. So imagine that historically, all these beautiful goddess sculptures where you had these rounded buttocks and big thighs and beautiful pendulous breasts and all different forms, right? You had skinny goddesses, you had fat goddesses, you had big boobed goddesses, you had no boobed goddesses with big booties. I mean, you should go and look at these old sculptures that they found in Greece and, you know, everywhere really in the old world. And they were buried. And so what that says to the feminine aspect of our being, men and women, is that there is a part of you that you need to bury. And I'm not just talking about a statue made out of stone in the ground. I'm talking about your psyche. There is a part of your being that is bad and unworthy, and you need to bury it. And, you know, poor men are even way more susceptible to burying her, but all of us are. And I'm getting emotional even just saying it, you know? And so when we bury things, we bury the old images. And when we do that, you guys, what it creates in us and what we're living out right now as a collective and as individuals is a psychic conflict. There is a part of me that has been wronged and buried, and that keeping things hidden requires an incredible amount of energetic and psychic effort. It's like a slinky. You have to keep pushing it down, but then one day it's just going to explode. And oftentimes it explodes anyway. And you get this sort of thing, the energy of the feminine coming out in unsavory and unhelpful and unhealthy ways. And so today we're going to talk about the sacred whore or the sacred prostitute, the queen archetype, and the little lost unworthy girl, sometimes known as the slave girl. All of us hold these different archetypes inside of us to greater and lesser extents. And so when we speak about the sacred prostitute or the queen or the goddess, you know, she has many different names. One of my favorite is Athena, right? Venus. And Aphrodite is another of her names. Aphrodite, Venus, Lakshmi, right? You have these goddesses of sexuality, sensuality, love, passion, great vitality, youthfulness, creativity, and they inspired awe. And so back in the day, you had these temple priestesses and you had temple prostitutes. And when we say sacred prostitute, what often happens in our psyche is we get the schism where we go, hey, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense to me. That's not right for me. There's a paradox in our Western mind when we say the word sacred and whore, or sacred and prostitute, or even sacred and sex, sacred and sexuality. And so it need not be this way. What we are attempting to do here at Shakti School is to bring the prostitute, the whore, the sexual one, the priestess, the sensual one, the Aphrodite consciousness back inside the temple. And what does that mean? It doesn't mean that we need to build a temple and all become courtesans of the divine, right? We can. But what it does mean for us just in our everyday life is that the part of me that loves my sensuality and my sexuality, the part of me that loves my wildness and my passion and my creativity, the part of me that's kind of a naughty little animal that loves sex and enjoys her pleasure and enjoys her fantasy world, that part of me gets to coincide and be consecrated, is the word, by my connection to spirit. And if you don't mind the word God, I don't. And because God is the masculine form, and it's beautiful, because what it's saying is I'm giving my body to God. I'm giving my sexuality to God. I'm giving my movement to God. I'm giving my emotions and my feeling to God. And as the feminine, I give it to this masculine. And when you do that, of course, this is all happening inside yourself, your being becomes inseminated. And what that means on a spiritual level is that you become full. If you think about the sexual act between a woman and a man, and this can easily be applied to a lesbian couple as well, because in that polarity, one can play the role of the masculine and the feminine. But when I give myself, when I open myself to receive, and when I as the masculine give myself, and then there's something to receive myself, we get what? Well, if you're talking about a man and a woman, you can get a baby. You can get a whole new life form. But the deeper esoteric meaning, you guys, is that you get life force. You get something new. You get something other than the ego structure. You get an alchemical creation. You enter into this sacred act of creating the world. And that's really powerful and brings a lot of life force and energy into your body. And I think one of the reasons for our collective health issues is that we have separated those two things, the masculine and the feminine, the patriarchal and the more natural, vital, sexual, feminine way of being. I want to go back to that paradigm, that duality of the patriarchal and the masculine. Jung describes it as the animus of the masculine versus the anima of the feminine. The patriarchal masculine is wonderful, right? When balanced by the feminine, the patriarchal masculine creates social structures. I remember one of my tantra teachers says, Shakti, this divine life force, it needs a structure to flow through. And we get that, right? Like if I'm just a crazy emotional mess, It's sometimes necessary to just be a crazy emotional mess, but emotional looks a lot better when it has a structure through which it can be observed through. If I'm just creative, but I don't have a paintbrush and a canvas, I don't have a structure to put that creativity upon. If I'm just creative, but I don't have a pen and paper, I don't become a writer, right? If I'm just creative, but I don't have a womb, the baby has nowhere to live. And so creativity requires structure. And that's where we can celebrate the masculine, right? The masculine is really good at building structures. And in the physical world, it's really good at building really cool buildings, right? It's really good about at mechanical activities, right? It's really good at protecting us if need be. But if unmet in equal measure by the feminine, it becomes over-mechanized. It becomes over-politicized. It becomes over-socialized. It becomes over-militarized. It becomes over-medicalized. It becomes over-medicated, right? And I know you know where I'm going with this. This is our reality, right? And so in that unbalanced masculine, we get this overvaluation of an aspect of our being that's really great. But if you overvalue it, if you overvalue anything, you get disease. And so we have this overvaluation in our culture and in our bodies. Ladies, listen to me. Our bodies have overvalued the masculine, and that in our brain is the front brain. It's the logical logos, the word, right? The thinking, the analyzing, the deducing part of ourselves. There is this pervasive overvaluing and even orienting towards only half of who we are, and not even half, right? It's less than that. And that desecrates nature. It desecrates the health of our bodies. This overvalue of doing and achieving and thinking leaves the feminine atrophied. She's starving inside of us. And she'll put up with it for a little while, but then she becomes ferocious. And this is where you get these visions of Kali or Durga, where you get these wild Chamunda, these sort of ruthless, wrathful mothers. And it's like they're coming out because they haven't been respected. So let's talk about what balances all these things that I just said. And these are all things in all of us. What balances is this valuation of the queenly side of ourselves, this Venus emerging from the sea, this Lakshmi emerging from the sea. In the word for it, we call nature, right? Mother Nature. And I love, if you go back to the Latin of nature, is natura. And natura actually means birth. Natura means universe. It means that which is inborn in us. Natura means that which is real versus artificial, right? The goddess is instinctive. She's erotic. She's dynamic. She places a lot of emphasis on the way that we're all connected and the way that we're all worthy and related to one another. She attends to one another. She attends to nature. She attends to babies. She attends to feeding. She attends to loving. She attends to giving her body through passionate lovemaking. There's no achieving in lovemaking. There's no achieving, right? She is the health of our body and our psyche. She is the law of the erotic, the eros, this inner law of our mental, emotional, pranic energy that understands our relatedness, that understands our the power in connection. She values being and feeling just as much as achieving and doing. And so in Shakti school, what we spend a lot of time doing, I mean, we definitely work with the masculine. I mean, I'm a very masculine person, and all of our teachers are very intelligent, logical, analytical, scientific women. But we give equal, if not more value, because it's so desperately lacking, to being able to feel and sense into the reality of our bones and into the reality of our body and into the reality of our organs. And so we do a lot of meditation on our actual physical body. It is what is real. We do a lot of allowing for the emotions to come through, but without indulging them and without putting a lot of logos or story around emotion. Coming back to this idea of the sacred prostitute inside of all of us, this connection between our sex and our body and our ability to sense our body and really just being a woman, and the way that that has been through a long history of our culture demonized has, I think, a lot to do with our imbalances mentally and emotionally. You can imagine back in the day that there was a certain aspect of our psyche that was soothed by having sensuality, dance, sexuality be a part of church. Imagine that, you guys. What if our, you know, church celebrated our body movements and our sensuality? We did this back in the day. The sacred prostitute or the sacred temple priestess was venerated because the ancient people understood that there's an excitement. It doesn't, I'm not even talking about intercourse, by the way. There is an excitement when you see a woman moving her body, or a man. There is a titillation. There's an excitement when you see someone in communication, soul to body. That's what we call an amazing dancer or singer or artist. It's someone whose body is in communication with their soul. There is something so sacred in that, that causes in the witness joy, and that beauty and that creativity can come through in me when I see it in someone else. And so joy and beauty and creativity were really valued. And when someone's in tune with their sensuality and in communication, body to soul, it inspires others to have the same. And so spirituality and sexuality were always, in the goddess traditions, very much tied together. Imagine that your animal nature, your sensual nature, your pleasure nature, your human nature, your sensuality, imagine it as the fuel that feeds the God seeking, that our pursuit for pleasure and our pursuit for spiritual unfolding were intimately connected, that our sensuality and our excitement and our pleasure and our joy were fuel for the fire of God. Unfortunately, that is not the message I got, and probably you didn't too. And so our sexuality is demonized, and people over time just lost respect for love and passion and sex and the body. We lost respect for it. Sex and spirituality were seen as something that could not coexist. In fact, they were opposites, in placed in this realm of the opposite. And so what happens? Well, what happens is our sex power, our sensuality, our desire, and our passion have to go underground. And this is the reality of many of us. We have buried the goddess. Sex has gone underground. So many of us, every woman I know, in fact, is feeling this sense of being unworthy. Marianne Williamson calls it a slave girl. In her book, Woman's Worth, one of my favorite books, she says, more women cry loudly or silently every fraction of every moment in every town of every country than anyone realizes. We cry for our children, we cry for our lovers, our parents, and ourselves. We cry in shame because we don't feel we have the right to cry. We cry for the world, yet we think we cry alone. Womanhood today, she says, is tentative and unsure, a thing defined more by what it isn't than what it is. Womanhood is a mass pain of unspoken depth, and when we try to speak about it, we're liable to be told, there you go, complaining again. As long as this is true, not half, but all of humanity is obstructed in its journey to our cosmic destination. This destination is far, far away, a place so deep inside us that we have barely glimpsed the outer walls. At every moment, she says, a woman makes a choice between the state of being a queen and the state of a slave girl. In our natural state, we are glorious beings. In the world of illusion, we are lost and imprisoned, slaves to our appetites and our will to false power. Our jailer is a three-headed monster, one head our past, one our insecurity, and one our popular culture. Our past is a story existing only in our minds. Look, analyze, understand, and forgive. Our insecurity is inevitable in the absence of personal meaning. Without a sense of connection to deeper, more noble ideas, we are doomed to a desperate struggle for things that fill us up. The job, the relationships, the looks, the body. We are tyrannized by a belief that we are inadequate. No Nazi with a machine gun could be more tormenting of a presence. Ugh, what powerful words. Very strong, right? But this really speaks to this schism in our body as women. When Venus went underground, we took this sacred prostitute out of the temple, guys, and we threw her out in the streets, right? Our creativity wanes. We get anxiety because the sensations in my body are labeled as bad. We have dullness and depression. We feel unloved and unworthy because our sexuality, our body, the thing that ignites us, our pleasure power, we've been told consciously and unconsciously, subconsciously, that these things are bad and they have to be controlled. And sex and spirituality become opposites instead of these coexisting pathways to God. And so what does it look like when the queen, when the Venus gets thrown out of the temple and into the streets? Well, what it looks like is literally that, the prostitute out on the street, unprotected, being abused by her pimp. And what it looks like for many of us is the endless advertising that we are subject to, whereby the hot, fake-breasted blonde is being propped up on top of an automobile, right? This is Venus, our sensuality power, sex sells, right? But it's been commodified. It's been turned into some prop to sell more for mostly men, if we're being honest. And so the purpose of what we're doing here in these Tantra talks, on this podcast, in Shakti School in general, and in the work that we do in Ayurveda School, which I hope, it starts, by the way, in January. We already have 80-some women coming for next year. I really hope you'll consider it. If my words are touching you and you really want to be a part of a tribe of women that are committed to opening up these psychic and emotional and physiological doorways, if you're ready to unbury the goddess, then come aboard, right? It starts in January. Link in the show notes, Ayurveda School Level 1. It's not just Ayurveda School. It's Ayurveda Tantra School. In fact, I think we're going to change the name because this is the kind of stuff we go into in depth. You cannot be healthy without these things that I'm talking about. We can't be fully healthy until we have liberated these energies inside of us. And so the purpose of the work we do is to really bring conscious awareness to these lost aspects of our mind and our body that have been so devalued and abused and even demonized and lost to us. And we do it practically through giving this energy an actual home in your body through meditating on your physical structure. She needs to have a place where she feels safe. And so we do this through emotional, energetic, and physical techniques. We're also interested in discovering the deep interrelatedness between sensing and our spirit, between our psycho-emotional health and our sensuality. And so I'm excited to continue to give her value in my life. I'm excited to teach you guys the daily practices that will enable you to express her throughout the day. And I really think that this will give a new dimension to your life and will increase your erotic creativity and passion as well. There's so much more I could say on this. It's just such a big topic. I hope it's gotten you curious about your own inner sacred queen, your sacred priestess, temple priestess, your sensuality, and the way that these things really matter to your spiritual path. I hope you'll join us for Ayurveda School. As I said, it's coming up in January. We also have an entire 5-day retreat happening on this in Charlottesville, Virginia. Link in the show notes. I think we've got like 2 more spots left if you want to come see us in Charlottesville. But the cool thing is that we're offering this training online. You can do it from home with us. We'll have live streaming of the OJAS training. OJAS. OJAS is all about this Venus stuff. It's about activating this sort of psychophysiological sensuality in the body and how that relates to your physical and emotional health. So that's happening November 1st through 5th. You can get the link, come join us. You can do it live stream with us, do a little home retreat from your house, or you can watch it anytime after that. If you're listening to this podcast after November 1st, you can find it in our store for purchase afterwards. So definitely check out the OJAS training. If this talk is something that you are in any way turned on by, which I think you will be because, oh my God, so many of us just know that this is sort of our sexuality is sort of the lost terrain of our, of women's spiritual life. So check it out. Thanks for listening, you guys. And if you like us, subscribe to the podcast. It helps people find us and leave us a great review. We really appreciate it. All right, guys, have a beautiful day, and we'll see you next week on the Ghee Spot. Put the pull upon the suitcase.